Good morning, Mount Zion. Hey, glad to be in the Lord's house this morning. A lot of pretty faces, a lot of good folk out here today. We come to praise and worship the Lord. Amen. Stand in the house, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Ask God to move in the service, touch our hearts, touch our lives, and intervene here today. Can we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for your power. We thank you, Lord, for Jesus Christ, oh God, who so long ago stepped down from heaven, God, to save and redeem those that will believe upon him. We pray, God, we leave our troubles at the door, and we come with our hearts and our lives lifted up to Christ today. Thanking you, God, for salvation. Thanking you, God, for being in this house, God, so sweetly and greatly, Lord. I pray we would come, Lord, our hearts in adoration and praise, Lord, to you and glorify who Christ is and what he has accomplished, Lord, for us. We praise you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus said, because I live, you can live also. And so we're thankful for the living power and the resurrection that Jesus Christ has given us as his church. We can tell others about that saving knowledge and saving power. Amen. We thank God for Jesus today. If you got your bulletins today, we welcome you once again. And the women's auxiliary meeting is Tuesday night at 8 o'clock, 7 p.m. All ladies are invited to attend. And I think it's a good time of fellowship and Bible study together and also discussing events the ladies are putting together. Team Kid, having that Wednesday night, continuing that. Come out and be with us at 6:30 for supper, 7 o'clock for the lesson. And we've been having the kids come into sanctuary with us to close out in prayer together. And the kids are enjoying doing that. And so we'll continue to do that this Wednesday night. I'm going to have a baptismal service probably 1st of March. We're going to have probably the Sunday morning service in the sanctuary for that special event. If you want to get baptized, let me know on that Sunday. And I'm going to have a sign-up sheet if you want to do so. And we'll plan to do a baptismal service that Sunday morning. And so looking forward to that. Also, last Sunday night of this month, I want to have a business meeting. We're supposed to do that in January, but with the snow and everything, we couldn't do so. But last Sunday night in February, we'll plan a business meeting. Those are two events that I've got on my calendar to plan accordingly. Anything else? Is there a need in the house? Uplifted hand. Anything outspoken? Absolutely. There's been a lot of death lately in the community, so we need to pray for all those that have been impacted by that, that God will bring some comfort and some peace. All right. Be praying for God over that. Thank God for that. Amen. That's awesome. Thank God for longevity. And this time you can spend with him. That's a blessing.
We went to see Lady Dayton. They're at home now, but they're still in bad shape. They still need some prayer.
All right, I'll be praying for them. Thank God. Amen. That's right. Amen. Good to have y'all back this morning. All right. Be praying for God. God touch her. Amen. So we'll be praying for her. God give her some comfort and peace during this time. And they'll find some answers for you guys. Yes, Vicki Bradley and the family. Remember her and them. Billy Ray. All right. We'll be praying for them. Yes. He was in a bad accident last week. And I had to have a couple of surgeries. And we'll be praying for him, his speedy recovery. That's it. Amen. Amen.
That's it. Amen. Amen. That's right. When you know Jesus Christ is always a winning sign, not a losing sign. So we're working from victory. All right, so we're going to believe God for that today. Yes, Italy, go ahead. That's right, amen, amen. Anybody else? Thank God for that. Anybody else?
I got one, Matt. Pray for my family, man. My uncle passed away recently, and my aunt, her, well, my uncle and my aunt were married for 65 years, and I know she's going to have a child going forward. So I'd like to pray for her.
All right. We pray for that. See ya. And thank God for that. Amen. Amen. Good, Jerry. All right. We pray about that. We've got some walking, talking testimonies. Go ahead, Karen. That's a blessing. Church, we've seen God do some wonderful things. But our God's not done answering prayer. He's not done healing. He's not done setting free as of yet. Can we stand over the house and come in agreement and pray and ask God to touch the circumstances here, the situations, the sicknesses, those that have lost those dear things? Can we pray and believe God as a church body today? Can we pray? Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we're thankful, God, you're a healer. We're thankful, God, you've got delivering power, oh God, that rushes over the soul when we speak the name of Jesus, oh Lord. That name is greater, God, than any name among the face of the earth or the heavens above. And we come to declare it, God, today. We thank you, God, for what you've accomplished and what you have done. We praise your name, God. We sing 1,000 hallelujahs, God, to you for what you have done, God, and what you've accomplished, Lord, for us. But Lord, there's still souls that need to be touched, bodies, God, that need to be mended and healed. And we know, God, today you've got the power back. Your blood that still flows down Calvary, oh God, to reach down and touch those that need an impact of you. We're praying, God, to declare the things of heaven, oh God, to be done on earth, God, as you desire us to do. Let your will be accomplished, God, in every life, every heart, every mind, every body, Lord, today.
Let us leave our troubles at the door and bring our praises, God, to you who's able to bring us through anything, God, any obstacle we face, God, you can bring us through it, God. So we come, God, with a heart of praise, a heart of adoration, a heart, God, that says, Lord, whatever you desire us to do, we're going to do that today as we proclamate the name of Jesus Christ and his kingdom come, God, and his will be done. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
DJ here. I can't see DJ. I think he's got it. Thank you, DJ. We appreciate it.
Struggling on.
Sometimes it's easy to get our eyes on the trials and the tribulations instead of the triumph that Jesus Christ has given us. One day we're going to testify on the other side about how great he is, how wonderful he is to get on from this side to that side. This time the tithes and offerings, ushers, come forward, please. Todd, give us a blessing this morning.
Hey, good morning, everyone. Oh, wow. I just love hearing all those testimonies this morning and praises. I know we've all got a lot to pray about, but wow. That just goes to show you God's answering prayers in this church. On the way to service this morning, I had another song picked out, and I want to thank Mike for learning the song this morning last minute, but it kind of goes last week. Brother Matt's always got a great message, but his message just kept resonating to me through the week about confidence as Christians. You know, we need to walk with confidence, you know, knowing we are saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. I mean, we have no reason to walk around in fear. You know, we need to disciple, and we need to walk around in confidence. I'm going to try to sing this song, Confidence. We never really tried this song, but it's called Confidence, and if you know it, sing the words with us. If not, I hope it blesses someone. I'm not a warrior. I'm too afraid to choose. I feel unqualified for what calling me to. But Lord, with your strength, I got no excuse. 'Cause broken people are exactly who you choose. So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me heart like David. Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. You took a shepherd boy and you made him king. Someone could trust you and give you everything. I'll be a conqueror, 'cause you fight for me. I'll be a champion, dreaming your victory. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in wilderness. Give me heart like David, Lord, be my defense, so I can face my giants with confidence. I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the walls. I won't stop until I see them fall. I'm gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus, Jesus, I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the walls. I won't stop until I see them fall. I'm gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus, Jesus, I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. I won't stop until I see them fall. I'm gonna sing up till I see them fall. Jesus, Jesus, I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the walls. I won't stand up till I see them fall. I'm gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus. So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. Faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like David in the wilderness. Give me heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. So I can face my giants with confidence. Amen. Thank you.
I mean, got confidence today. Only by the blood of the Lamb. Thank God for that. Good word, Keith. Yes. Absolutely.
All right, here we go. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Down my heart to fear, and face my fear, relief, whilst gracious is that gracious. The hour I first believed, and we've been there 10,000 years. Night shining as the sun, we praise God, 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 praise God. Praise God, praise God. Amen.
Avery. Got a special treat today.
You guys want mics?
Check.
Today we're going to be singing "And We'll Say My Jesus."
To wait for the song to play.
Now wait for the thing.
Feeling, 'cause shame's done all it's stealing.
desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Tears from broken dreams and wasted years until the past to disappear. Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus.
And all the wrong turns that you would go on undo if you could. Who could work it out for your good?
Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The price for all my guilty. Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Ooh. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
God's raising another generation. Amen. Ones that'll know that name, Jesus Christ, above everything else. Thank God for Jesus Christ. This time, Children's Church and Nursery. Always say it takes half the church. That's what it's all about, though, right? Thank God we got another generation to tell Jesus Christ to. They can relay it, they can present it, and they can live in their generation if God does endure and time does continue on. I want to take us to the Word today and try to help us. I want to relay to us what it really means to have a testimony for Jesus Christ. You know, Christians are supposed to be some of the most happiest folks in the world. But sometimes they're some of the most saddest. If you got your Bible this morning, Book of Mark, Chapter 5, we'll start in verse 15 and read down to 19, or verse 20, and let you know what it really looks like to have a story to tell. How many got a story this morning? I'm not going to worry about the time today. We're just going to preach till God's done. Amen. Hollywood movies last an average an hour and a half, 2 hours long, and folks soak them up all the time. We come to the house of God, we can get what we need from the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Supper can wait. Mark chapter 5, verse 15. Amen, if you're with me. It says, they come to Jesus and see him who was possessed with the devil and had the legion sitting and clothed in his right mind, and they were afraid. And they who saw it told him how it befell to him who was possessed with the devil, and how also concerning the swine. And they began to pray him to depart out of their coast. And when he was come to the ship, talking about legion, he had been possessed with the devil, prayed him that he might be with him. Howbeit Jesus suffered him not, but said unto him, go home and tell your friends, and tell them how great things the Lord has done for you, and how has had compassion on you. And it says he departed and began to publish in Decapolis great things that Jesus had done for him, and all men did marvel. I'm going to preach. If God will help me today with a few minutes, I've got a story to tell. Can we pray one more time? Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we're thankful, God, for your word. Your word, God, that leads us the example of how to live, God, how to conduct our lives, and how we're supposed to present that gospel message everywhere we go. I'm praying, God, for there being a power presented in your house today that will compel your people, God, to get up and rejoice at what Jesus Christ has done and what he's continuing to do, Lord. You're not done working yet. You're still working on our lives and our hearts, God. And we're believing, Lord, today for your word to go forth in power, to challenge us, to transition us, and to change us into what you have us to be. Because we've got a story to tell. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Jesus comes to this coast, and a man there is possessed by a devil. No man could contain him. No man could put chains and wrap him up. He was untamable. He would walk among the tombs and cry even in the nighttime, the daytime. It didn't matter. He was a man that was crying and possessed by the devil himself. But when Jesus Christ come on board them shores, his destiny changed, his outlook changed, he changed, and his testimony changed. Can I tell somebody today, I've got a story to tell, because Christ come on board my life, he come on board the vessel of my soul, and it changed me. Have you been changed today? You see, there's a lot of folks walking in a lot of different elements in life. Some walk among the deadness of this world the way Legion walked among the deadness of his day. We walk among the tombstones of this world in which we live in. We kick around the death and we see turmoil. We see tribulation and persecution on every side. We see darkness and perversion everywhere. And we thank God, can there anything great come out of this world? But I'm going to tell you, when Christ comes inside of our lives and changes us, there's a light that is produced, and it expels the darkness, and you've got a story to tell about the light of day that shined upon our souls. How many got a story to tell today? This man believed on Jesus. He came and worshipped him. Build this foundation this morning, then we're going to go to preaching. He came and worshipped him. He came to acknowledge him. He acknowledged he was a son of God. As he acknowledged that, Jesus Christ stretched his hands out and delivered him. And after that man was delivered, can I tell you, the town got in the uproar, and they went and told something's going on down there on that mountaintop. That man that we couldn't bind, that man that was possessed, that man that yelled out and cried all the night long, he's clothed in his right mind. Something divine has happened to him. They come a-running, and they begin to kick Jesus out of the coast. They didn't understand. You see, when the Spirit of God begins to move on our lives and move upon our hearts, the world can't understand that, because we got a story they can't recognize, they can't understand. But can I tell you that story? They can kick Jesus out of the schools, can kick him out of the court system, but I'm going to tell you the stories of those that have been impacted by Christ himself. It will live on. Our youngest we send to schools where they've kicked Christ out of, they're going to sing about my Jesus. Oh, I got a story to tell. My Jesus, who is still the same, the yesterday, today, and forever, he's still saving souls.
They can kick him out of the court system in the court, in the court halls, take the Ten Commandments down. But I'm going to tell you, when I go to the courtroom, I'm still telling them that Jesus Christ will not change. And he's touched my life. The alcoholic, the drug addict, all those that come to that place, the man named Jesus can save them. Christ has impacted down through the ages those that have come to him by faith and received that. And they got a story to tell. Jesus, I want to go with you, is what Legion told him. Jesus says, you know what? I'm going on to the other side, but you got a story to go back and tell everybody around you. Can I tell you, when I got saved and right with God, I want to tell everybody about the saving knowledge of Jesus. I was once bound, but now I'm free. I used couldn't get around, but now Jesus has come and rescued my soul. I've got a story to tell. If you go in that workplace and they're telling all the stories of their lives, everything they possess, everything they own, I don't make no never mind to me. I just tell them, oh, I've got Jesus. All those things are going to be left behind. But what I'm going on to is Jesus. Do you tell your story everywhere you go? Broadcast it. Talk about it. Relay it. In John chapter 9, there was a man that was blind from birth. Jesus comes along, that man says, Jesus, can you heal me? If you believe I can do anything, Jesus would tell him. Jesus stooped down, took some clay, and took some spittle and put that together and put it on that man's eyes and anointed them. What does that mean, Pastor? You see, me and you are clay and we are dust. And that clay and dust alone can't do anything. The dust we are and the dust we shall return. But I'm going to tell you, in the garden, when God created Adam in dust, he breathed life into him. He became a living, breathing soul. You see, when Christ touches our clay, we become a living, breathing example of what it can do, what it has done, and what it will do. That spittle is a representation of the divine power accompanied with our clay and the testimony that arises from that. The man was healed, and he began to talk about what God had done for him. I was blind. I've never seen the trees. I've never seen the grass. I've never seen the beauty of this earth. But now I see all of that. Why? Because the story I am telling is that because Jesus impacted my life. You listen to me. Religious folk come around and said, I don't understand. You say you were blind, but now you see. How did that happen? They asked his parents, was he blind from the womb? They said, yes. They said, well, explain it to us. We can't explain it. Ask him. Let him tell you. Can I tell you, I cannot explain the mechanics of salvation. I mean, I can't understand how God comes down inside of my soul and transitions and transforms me. I don't know how the shackles are broken in the spirit, but all I can tell you is that it happened, and I'm a man free today because of Jesus Christ. He says, I don't know. He says, the one thing I do know, I once was blind, but now I see. I don't know how it happened, but I know Jesus touched me. I've got a story to tell. I can see because that man Jesus saved me and reached me in a place that was unreachable. Religion can only get you so far. It only can point you to a law or a regulation. Religion and formation, people come to church all the time and they go through the ritual. Well, they say, well, I hope he quits by 12 o'clock and then we'll all go home and do our own thing. But I'm going to tell you this morning, church is not about a religion. It's not about a formation. It's not about a time clock. But it's a story that we tell about the Lamb of God that came to take away the sin of the world. If we lose our story and lose our identification with Christ and make it mere religion, can I tell you, we're all blinded today. We're all on the road to hell. But when that religion is changed into a relationship, when the divine presence of God touches my ailment and I begin to see in the spirit, there is a whole different world opened up to me as it is to all of us. You see, my life, I grew up a pastor's son. They always say the preacher's kids are the worst, right? I'm learning that in my three.
I'm just kidding, they're good kids. I grew up a pastor's son. I grew up in the church. Understood what it meant to be in church Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday. There was no excuse. We were just there. I don't want to go tonight, Daddy. You get in the car and go on. I remember my little brother. We'd be on the way to church. He's fixing his hair, trying to put his clothes on, riding down the road. It was four of us. He was the last one. He never got ready on time. But we was on the way to church always, and we were in that building. I heard my dad preach message after message, sermon after sermon. And I'm going to tell you, when I become of age, I become 17, 18 years old, I run astray. I said, I've learned that my whole life. I'm going to go try something different. I'm going to go experience life a little bit. And can I tell you, church, in that world, there's nothing but darkness and bleakness. There ain't no light of day. There is no freedom. It's nothing but bondage. And I said, Lord, I'm not going to live this way. But I can't save myself. I can see myself now in the spirit. A lamb that had wandered off from the flock. A lamb that had gone astray. Had tainted my garment. Was ashamed to even look at Jesus Christ with my filthy rags. But I'm going to tell you, I saw him one day coming over that mountaintop. Coming up Mount Calvary. And he come and looked in the situation where I was at. He says, Matt, I've called you, I've raised you, and I'm going to heal you. I don't deserve that, but I can tell you this morning, I've got a story to tell. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Oh, thank God for that. Are you lost this morning? Jesus Christ, our great shepherd, will help you find your way and give you a story to tell about that power of coming back to him. See, the song was on point this morning with Amazing Grace. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but now I see. It's wonderful how God works, ain't it? Jesus Christ goes to the cross. The disciples are in a state of depression. Come out of this thing. In a state of depression, they're thinking Jesus Christ, his head is going to rise, but he's on a cross. Ain't nobody surrounding him no more. All his followers have gone another direction. And they think, you know what, the story's over. We've seen this man heal. We've seen him touch blinded eyes. We've seen him raise the dead. We've seen him heal those that are lame. We've seen him do all those things, but I guess the story is over now. They put him in a tomb for 3 days. On the third day, Mary Magdalene come down to that tomb. The disciples are staying back. They're still pouting and crying about what they're going to do next. And Mary Magdalene goes to that tomb, and she sees a stone rolled away. And an angel told her, won't you go tell my disciples? Go tell them that follow Jesus that he's going to appear unto you. He told you he's going to rise the third day. He let you know what was going to happen. Mary Magdalene said, oh, I got a story to tell. And she ran back to them disciples. And she said, hey, Jesus Christ has rose. He ain't in that tomb no more. You need to get up and praise God because the story is not over yet. We think when Satan puts us in a place and compromises our mind and puts us in a box, in a situation there where we can't get out, it's a dire place. But I'm going to tell you, when resurrection walks in and he says, I've called you and raised you in the resurrection, you're no longer dead. You tell me and you, come out of that tomb, you're raised to new life. Where's your tomb today? Where are you at today? Has your story stopped? I hate reading the same chapter over and over again in a Bible, or in a book. I'm not a Bible, but a book. I don't like watching the same movie over and over again. I know what's going to happen. Follow me on this. Every one of our lives is the open book that God is writing. If we give him the pen, or we can write the story ourselves. But if you write the story yourself, can I tell you, it's nothing more but a cycle. Oh, I come to church, I feel good with God, and then I go back to the motions. I'm back to the same way on Monday. I may do good for a month, my story starts over again. It's the same chapter in our life, just cycled over and repeating itself. We're so predictable that even the devil himself, well, they're just going to rewrite the story again. I don't have to worry about that. If we don't give the pen to Jesus Christ and tell him to write the story, church, it's the same old thing. You fall into the same sins. You fall into the same transgressions. You fall into the same iniquity. And you're stumbling over the same thing you stumbled on last week.
You see, Jesus Christ wants to write a new story in our lives. He wants to start a new chapter in our lives. You say, well, how does he do that? When you become saved and God writes that chapter of salvation in your life, the next chapter should be sanctification. That means growing in God. That means he wrote my chapter of salvation, and he's writing that story, but then he moves on to chapter 2, and he sanctifies me. In chapter 3, he fills me with the Spirit of God, and he compels me to go preach. You've got to continue on and let God write this story. What about if you have got to chapter 3 and you're in chapter 4, where the tribulation, the trial is so great and so real and so strong you can't seem to make it through? What about chapter 4 when you're stuck in that place of that story, and the story that you tell your neighbors, the story you tell your church family is the woes of life? Oh, I'm trialed again. I'm tribulated again. I'm suffering things at my job. I'm suffering in my mind. I'm suffering my spirit. And that's the story that you tell. And it's over and over and over again. I wish somebody would get to chapter 5. In chapter 5 in the Word of God is the number of grace. When you come to chapter 5, it's an overcoming chapter. I've been saved. I've been sanctified. I've been filled with the Spirit. And I've overcome the trials of this life. I've got a story to tell of victory in chapter 5. What chapter are you stuck in today? What chapter do you want to move on from that you've got a more complete story to tell? People don't want to hear just a piece of your life. They don't know how Jesus impacted all of it. If they say, well, you're just a Sunday morning Christian, they don't understand how you walk with God the rest of the week. You're just telling one half of the story. I don't like storytelling when it's lies. But I like the complete, unadulterated truth. Amen. I ain't done yet. In the book of Revelation, it talks about 144,000. 12,000 per tribe of the children of Israel. And a lot of folks have run wild with this. The Church of Mormon and Jehovah's Witness, they think they're part of that 144. And I tell you, that ain't right. These are Jews. They ain't Gentiles. But there is a representation here. There's a representation of those that have been redeemed. How many know every good song has a story behind it? The song Keith sung this morning has got a story behind it. Ann Wilson has got a story behind it. A lot of times people write songs based upon stories. This 144,000, it says that they get around the throne of God and they sing a new song. It says in Revelation chapter 15, they sing the song of Moses, and then it says they sing the song of the Lamb. Can I tell you this more, what that means and represents to me? They sing the song of Moses, where they overcome this life, where God threw down Satan and every power against the church, and then they sing the song of the Lamb, those that have been redeemed, and they sing that story in the heavenly place around the throne of God. I may get a song to sing this morning. When it talks about that 144, those redeemed, it says they got the victory over what? Over the Antichrist and his system. But listen to me. You see, John said we're facing that spirit of Antichrist in our day. Are we facing that church? Are you seeing that church? Are you seeing the deception? Are you seeing the darkness? Are you seeing the powers of hell being unleashed? Yes, we're seeing all those things. And sometimes that story, it's hard to tell in the face of that opposition. Listen. But it says these 144,000 representing the redeemed, me and you are redeemed this morning. It says they got the victory over the beast. That means they got the victory over the power of the beast. Can I tell the church this morning, greater is he that's in us than he that is in that world. Oh, Satan's got power, but Holy Ghost power is stronger than what the Satan brings to the table. They got the victory over the beast, over his power. It goes on and says they got victory over his image. That means they got the victory over his presence. You see, the image that is going to be erected in the latter days in that 7 years of tribulation is going to have an ability to speak and to talk. What does that mean this morning? Have you heard of artificial intelligence? These cell phones,
Most folks carry this around more than they carry the Bible around. I was watching a church service last night on YouTube, and the man's up there speaking and going on. Everybody's just video recording like this, getting every move he makes. You see, these devices, this artificial intelligence image, what it's talking about, it will have the ability to speak, and all those that don't, that have that mark, to fall down and worship the beast. We are living in a technological advancement of a generation, and sometimes we are so involved with technology that we refuse to engage the spiritual conflict that is around us. But it says these 144, it says they got the victory over the image, so they got the victory over the Antichrist's presence. There's a presence in our world that's not of God, it's of this world, and we got to overcome it. It says they got the victory over his mark. We are experiencing now a time of mandates, a time of pushing our freedoms against us. If you're a Christian believer today, you've got mandates that are coming against you. They're telling those in Canada they got to close the doors of the church, they got to shut all that down. And they're not allowing them to preach anymore. You see, that mark is a type of control that Satan wants over everything. I mean, no, Satan wants control. He wants to control your life, and he wants to control your story. It says they got the victory over the mark. That's a type of his control. Lastly, it says they got the victory over his number. Number 666, that system of 666 is present in our world. That means these redeemed, they got the victory over the system of the Antichrist. I'm telling the church this morning, you've got a story to tell in the middle of all these things that have come against us. We may be surrounded, but we're surrounded by God. And when you're surrounded by God, let what come, let what may. Our story is still to tell about the things of God. Do you tell your story or do you hide behind somebody else's story? Well, Pastor Matt, he preaches, he does that and all this. I come to church on Sunday. The story I tell you on Sunday, you go tell it on Monday. Do you tell about what God has done for you? I can tell you what he's done for me. What has he done for you? I'm working toward a close. In Joel 1 and 3, it says, tell ye your children of it. Let your children tell their children of it. And their children another generation. You see, stories were passed down through the ages about the things that God had done. And I want to tell the story how my grandmother stood for God. How my dad stood for God. How we plan to stand for God. And how if God does tell you, I want my children to stand for God. And the generation following them, church, you've got a story to relate to those coming up behind you about the things that God is doing and has done. Don't let the story fade and go away. If you don't have a story, you've got nothing to tell. Lastly, when the story is being told of your life and you come to Christ and that salvation message, there's going to be some fruits in your life that show you've got a story to tell. People can talk all they want to, but when the really rubber hits the road, is the fruit showing you have an identification with Jesus Christ. I can tell you all I want to. I've been saved. I've been found. My eyes have been opened to spiritual truths. But if I walk contrary to that story, then I have not really been bought by God. It's just my imagination and my tongue running wild. And it's not a change of heart. When God has really changed you and really made you new, there's some fruits that are available for you to see that you have been impacted by him. Amen or oh me, church. If you live like you want to during the week and not never been changed, then your story's wrong. But if you live like God has destined you to live, been changed by his wondrous power and by his blood, can I tell you that story will live on and that story will have some fruit to bear? You got an identification with God. One day, this is in Revelation 20 and 12, the book shall be opened. And it says, out of those books men will be judged. I just believe those books are our stories that we have written on this earth. Those that have stood for Christ and those that have stood against him. Because it says another book is open. That's the book of the Lamb. And it says all those not found there are cast to everlasting lake of fire. Can I tell you today, your book your story that God is allowing you to write by his penmanship is of most importance when you stand before God and have to give an account. Legion came and told them about what God had done. He published that. What are you going to do tomorrow, church? Are you going to publish this? Or are you going to let it sit on the shelf? Can we stand?